Student, did we complete this topic yesterday? Transducer, sensors, and actuators.
Sir, you told to start transducer, sir.
Pardon? Hello.
You told you'll start transducer, sir.
Transducer, sensors, actuators. So next, yes, I will upload this PPT in Moodle. Okay, student, yesterday we have discussed about sensors and transducers. Okay. Next topic, signal conditioning and display. If you observe block diagram, here we have signal conditioning and here we have signal conditioning. Sensor will give a data which is not suitable for the next process. So we require signal conditioning, and here we will get data from the computers or microcontrollers, which is a digital data. Many of the actuators are not able to receive digital data, so there also we need signal conditioning block. So in some cases, signal conditioning may be digital to analog converters or integrators, differentiators, amplifiers. In some cases, level shifters. So there is very important role the signal conditioning will play in process control, controlling any parameter in industry. Signal conditioners are measuring system elements that start with an electric sensor output signal and then yield a signal suitable for transmission, display, or recording, or that better meet the requirements of a subsequent standard equipment or device. So if you are using a sensor, and we have discussed about RTD, RTD is a sensor, it cannot give output as voltage or current, but it can give as resistance. In some cases, we can use a capacitive type of sensor, then capacitor will change its own capacitance depending on the variation of the physical parameter. So RTD will give resistance, and capacitive type of sensor will give capacitance variation. Depending on that variations, we can, yes. Depending on that variation, we can get output from the electrical circuits, and that analog voltage can be processed. So we need signal conditioning to modulate the sensor output, and the main role of signal conditioning circuit is to modulate that signal, and it has to produce an output depending on the sensor output, which is suitable for the further process. The normally consists of electronic circuits performing any of the following functions: amplification, level shifting, filtering, impedance matching, modulation, and demodulation. So these are the some kind of operations which can be performed by signal conditioning circuits. Amplification. In BEEE subject, we have studied which is amplifier. What is amplifier? Okay. So amplifier is an electronic circuit which can receive low input voltage and which can produce high output voltage. Amplifier is an electronic circuit which can receive low input voltage and which can produce high output voltage. If the sensor output is very, very less, if it is in millivolts, if you want to increase its magnitude, we can use amplification. And level shifting. Sometimes we have to decrease the sensor output. In rare cases, we have to decrease sensor output from large value to smaller value. In such cases, we can use level shifting and filtering. In electronics, we have different types of filter circuits like low pass filter, high pass filter, band pass filters. If we have too many signals, and if you are receiving too many signals at a time, and if you want to choose one of the signal, one of the group of the signals, we can use filters, electronic filters. So by changing the resistors and capacitors, we can select one type of signal. And always electronic circuits need high input signal conditioning circuits will provide this impedance matching also, because data transmission block has a low input impedance. Sensor output may damage the data transmission block. So in such case, we can introduce signal conditioning circuit, where signal conditioning circuit input impedance will be more and output impedance will be very less. So it can easily match with the sensor output and with the data transmission input port. Modulation and demodulation. Students, modulation means in electronics, if you have a low frequency signal and if you want to transmit it to the longer distances, if you want to transmit it, we have to modulate that signal with the high frequency signal. Or if we transmit low frequency signal at the receiver part, the main information we may lose because of some losses during this transmission. So if we modulate low frequency signal with the high frequency signal at the receiver section, we may not have that much large loss in the data, because again there we have filters which can extract exact signal from the modulated signal. And demodulation is opposite to the modulation. Demodulation means extraction of required signal from the high frequency signal. Extraction of low frequency signal or data signal from the modulated signal. That is called demodulation. Some standards call the sensor plus signal conditioner subsystem as a transmitter. One of the stages of measuring system is usually digital, and sensor output is analog. Analog to digital converters yield a digital port from an analog signal. Analog to digital converters will play very useful role in the controlling process, controlling a parameter, because sensor and signal conditioning device will give analog signal. Sometimes signal conditioning circuits may be analog to digital converters, because sensor is giving analog signal, computer will not understand or will not receive that analog signal. So we need analog to digital converters in between the computers and the sensor. So analog to digital converters will receive analog data, and it will convert it into equivalent digital data. ADCs have relatively low input impedance. And they require their input signal. To be DC, slowly varying with amplitude with specified margin, usually less than plus or minus 10 volts. So if you want to convert plus or minus 10 volts as a digital, we can use analog to digital converters. Therefore, sensor output output signals which may have an amplitude in the millivolts range. Therefore, sensor output signals which may have an amplitude in the millivolts range must be conditioned before they can be amplified, applied to the ADC. So here, the purpose of amplifier, I'm trying to explain. If the sensor output is very, very small in magnitude, we require amplifier. Because if you want to use analog to digital converters, if you want to use analog to digital converter, at least we have to give our voltages in between minus 10 to plus 10 volts. Minus 10 to plus 10 volts. But whereas sensor is giving output in millivolts, which is not suitable for the analog to digital converter. So what we have to do? We have to use amplifier in between the ADC and sensor. Then amplifier will receive that millivolts output from the sensor, and it will consider that millivolts voltage as input, and amplifier will amplify that millivolts, and it will produce output in between the minus 10 to 10 volts. To display of measured results, the display of measured results can be in an analog or in digital form. So if you want to use display systems, we can use monitors. Monitors can display waveforms or numbers or pictures. Or if you want to use only analog devices, you can use ammeter, voltmeter or wattmeter, ohmmeter to show the resistance. So all those devices will come under display systems. Or if you want to digital systems, you can use computer monitors or digital display systems like display systems in our elevators, which can display only numbers. The recording can be magnetic, electronic on paper, but the information to be recorded should always be in electrical form. The recording can be magnetic, electronic, or on paper. Students, in previous days we have audio cassettes and video cassettes. Those are called magnetic strips. If you want to store data, we used to store it on magnetic tapes. And in previous days, we used to utilize floppies to store data. So floppies have magnetic strip. They look like similar to CD, but CD can store data for longer time periods, but floppy can store data for the shorter time periods. And now, for example, for magnetic storing devices, audio cassettes and video cassettes. In those cassettes, we have magnetic strips. And electronic devices like our hard disk, USB, pen drives, all these comes under electronic storage devices. And paper. In hospitals, most of the human parameters, body parameters like ECG, EEG, they will take as printout. So that paper can be storage device for the body parameters, biological parameters. But the information to be recorded should always be in electrical form. So if you want to record on magnetic strip, you have to use electrical devices. And if you want to store data in pen drives or in hard disk, you have to use electrical devices. And if you want to make print on a paper, you have to use electrical devices. So all these devices comes under recording devices. Signal conditioning and display systems are very, very important controlling a parameter. And in some cases, we have to record the data. So magnetic, electronic, or on paper, these three we can use as storing devices. Next topic, interfaces, data domains and conversions. Interfaces, data domains and conversions. Interface is used to refer to signal modifying elements that operate in the electrical domain even when changing from one data domain to another, such as ADC. Interface is used to refer to signal modifying elements that operate in the electrical domain even when changing from one data domain to another, such as an ADC. ADC means analog to digital converter. So analog to digital converter, we can call that as an interface because it is receiving analog data and it is producing digital data. Data domain is the name of a quantity used to represent or transmit information. The concept of data domain and conversion between domains helps in describing sensors and electronic circuits associated with them. In some cases, we use only analog data. Analog data means voltage, current. This comes under analog data. In some cases, we use only digital data. In some cases, we use frequency or phase shift, pulse width. This comes under another type of domain. Okay. So if you observe figure here, students, half of the circle belongs to electrical domains. Remaining half of the circle belongs to non-electrical domains. And in electrical domains, we have three classifications. First one is analog. In analog, we have current, voltage, charge. And in time domain, we have three types: frequency, pulse width, and phase. And in digital, we have parallel, series, and counts. Students, in FDLC subject, we have seen resistors and counters. In resistors, we can insert data parallelly or we can insert data serially. Similarly, we can count the clock pulses. And in non-electrical, we have digital displays, analog displays, pioneer position, chemical domains, physical domains. All these domains we will discuss now. So this figure shows some possible domains, most of which are electrical. In the analog domain, we have amplitude, that is amplitude means voltage, current, charge. It can be power also. In the time domain, we have frequency, pulse width, and period counting. In the digital domain, we have signals, have only two values, zeros and ones. The information can be carried by the number of pulses or by a coded serial parallel word. The analog domain is the most prone to electrical interference. In the time domain, the coded variable cannot be measured, that is converted to numerical domain in a continuous way. Rather, a cycle or pulse duration must elapse. In the digital domain, numbers are easily displayed. So here, current we can measure, voltage we can measure, charge we can measure, power we can calculate by using current and voltage. And here, frequency. For frequency, pulse width and phase difference, we have to use time domain. We have to use time domain. If you want to represent frequency, again we need to use numbers only. And here we have digital domain. In digital domain, we have parallel data, serial data, or counting a pulse. In non-electrical, we have digital displays, analog displays. Digital displays means computer monitors or digital number display systems. Pioneer position. What is pioneer position? It is a device which can change position of needles in it depending on the variability of variable change. If you are using pioneer position, so in that pioneer position device, we have some needles. That needle will move from one place to another. Analog display. Analog display is nothing but voltmeter, ammeter, and wattmeter, which can show power reading. Like that, pioneer position device is also a device which can change the position of the needle in it depending on the input. And the chemical domains. If you want to represent chemical elements, or if you want to measure chemical elements, we have chemical domains also. And physical domains, if you want to measure length, if you want to measure volume, we have physical domains. So these are the non-electrical domains. And electrical domains, there are three categories: analog, time, and digital. Students, next topic, sensor classification. We have three categories, students, to classify sensors depending on the power supply, depending on the output signal, and depending on the operation mode. We have three categories to separate sensors depending on the power supply, output signal, and operation mode. Depending on the power supply, if we want to classify, we have two categories, modulating and self-generating. And depending on the output signal, if you want to classify analog and digital. And if you want to classify sensors depending on the operation mode, that is deflection and null. These are the different types of categories we have. And if you focus on thermistor, thermistor is a temperature sensor. Thermistor is a temperature sensor whose resistance will decrease if we increase resistance. If you have a thermistor, if you want to estimate temperature, and if the temperature is increasing continuously, if you place your thermistor near that atmosphere, if temperature increases, thermistor temperature will decrease. And what is thermocouple? Thermocouple is a device which can be constructed by using two different metallic wires. If we join those two metallic wires, we will get two junctions. And if you maintain those two junctions at two different temperatures, you will get a thermoelectricity in that metallic wires. And potentiometer. What is a potentiometer? It is a variable resistor. It has a knob. If you rotate that knob, its resistance will increase or decrease. Potentiometer is a variable resistor. If you rotate knob of the potentiometer, if you rotate it in clockwise, resistance will decrease. If you rotate in the anti-clockwise, resistance will increase. And position encoder. Position encoder is one type of sensor which can sense position of the other object. Position encoder is a device or a sensor which can sense position of the other object. It can be called as proximity sensor also. And deflection. Deflection accelerometer and servo accelerometer. Both devices are useful to measure acceleration. Deflection accelerometer and self accelerometer. Both devices are useful to estimate acceleration. In considering the need for power supply, sensors are classified as modulating or self-generating. In modulating sensors, most of the output signal power comes from an auxiliary power source. The input only controls the output. Conversely, in self-generating sensors, output power comes from the input. So if we compare this thermistor and thermocouple, you have to produce power supply to the thermistor. And thermistor will be connected in an electronic circuit. And if you change that electronic circuit temperature, then only thermistor will work. But temperature can change the thermistor resistance, but input will be voltage to that thermistor. Thermistor resistance will vary depending on the temperature, but that thermistor is connected in another electronic circuit. It will receive voltage as input. Because of this variable resistance, we will get change in output. That is called auxiliary power sources. In modulating sensors, most of the output signal power comes from an auxiliary power source. So here thermistor is example. Thermistor should be connected in an electronic circuit and we have to increase the atmospheric temperature. Then thermistor resistance will vary. Depending on that variations in resistance, we will get output variations. If we analyze that output variations, we can estimate the temperature. So in modulating sensors, power comes from an auxiliary power sources. The input only controls the output. Conversely, in self-generating sensors, output power comes from the input. So here, if we focus on thermocouple, we are not using any external voltage source or current source as input. We have two metallic wires and we have two different junctions. And if we maintain those two different junctions at two different temperatures, we will get EMF in that two metallic wires. So here, output power comes from the input. What is input? Two different temperatures. Modulating sensors usually require more wires than self-generating sensors because wires different from the signal wire supply power. Moreover, the presence of an auxiliary power source can increase the danger of explosion in explosive atmosphere. So, in comparatively, self-generating sensors are more useful. Modulating sensors have an advantage that the power supply voltage can be modified their overall sensitivity. If we take thermistor example, input voltage we can decrease or increase. Input voltage we can decrease or increase depending on the application. In analog sensors, the output changes. In analog sensors, the output changes in a continuous way at microscopic level. Macroscopic level. In analog sensors, the output changes in a continuous way at a macroscopic level. That means analog device will sense only large values. They cannot sense small values, low values. The information is usually obtained from the amplitude. Although sensors with output in time domain are usually considered as analog. So in previous slide we have, time domain data, frequency, pulse width and phase. Sometimes we can measure frequency in terms of voltage, pulse width in terms of voltage. So they comes under analog devices. Sensors whose output is a variable frequency, are called quasi-digital because it is very easy to obtain a digital output from them. They will receive frequency. Sensors will receive frequency and they will convert that frequency as digital data. If that is a sensor, we can call that sensor as quasi-digital. The output of digital sensors takes the form of discrete steps or states. They do not require an IDC and their output is easier to transmit that of analog sensors, also more repeatable and reliable and often more accurate. The output of digital sensors takes the form of discrete or states. They do not require an IDC and their output is easier to transmit than that of analog sensors, also more repeatable and reliable and often more accurate. So yesterday or 2 days back I have given how to calculate a measurement, a parameter. We have to use sensor and we have to use signal conditioning device and again we have to give the data to the computer systems. Why we are in computer systems? Because sometimes humans may do mistakes, but computer calculations always be accurate. So we have to depend on computers to find out the accurate values. And in comparatively, analog device will get damaged in very often, but computers will work for many years. So digital devices are more reliable than the analog devices. In considering the operating mode, sensors are classified in terms of their function in a deflection or null mode. Deflection or a null mode. Sometimes if we are using a device, after applying the parameter on it, it will reaches a reading to zero or it will show a zero, which is a signal that it has received that input signal. We have a device that we are using the device to sense one parameter, one physical parameter. After receiving that input, it will show a reading as zero. That is called null deflection. That zero represents presence of that physical parameter. In deflection sensors, the measured quantity produces a physical effect that generates in some part of the instrument a similar but opposing effect that is related to some useful variable. So here deflection sensors measured quantity produces a physical effect that generates in some part of the instrument a similar but opposing effect that is related to some useful variable. For example, a dynamometer to measure force is a sensor where the force to be measured deflects a spring. The point where the force is exerts proportion to its deformation balances the amplified applied force. So spring weighing machines we can use here to measure the force. Spring weighing machines we can use to measure the force. So thermistor, thermocouple, potentiometer, position encoder, deflection accelerometer and servo accelerometer. These are the examples for different type of sensors. And if you want to classify, we have three categories to classify depending on power supply, depending on output signal, depending on operation mode. And if we classify depending on the power supply, we have two categories, modulating, self-generating. And if we classify depending on the output signal, analog, digital devices. And if we classify depending on the operation mode, that is deflection and null mode. So these are the categories and classification of sensors. Students, so today onwards I will create links in Zoom. So I have today I tried to restrict the sections to attend this session. Next class onwards I will try to create Zoom links through Moodle only. If there are any changes, I will inform in the group. Okay, students.
Thank you, sir.
Right.